Lovely to see you all. My name's Robin Harper, former MSP and Vice President of ESU, now a trustee, and now the newly elected chair of the Scottish Wildlife Trust. And I've been invited here to introduce Anne-Marie Carey and then say some kind words at the end. Anne-Marie is a postdoctoral researcher working for the Photosynthetic Antenna Research Centre in Professor Richard Codgell's group at the University of Glasgow. Her research is focused on the structure and function of light harvesting complexes in purple bacteria. That sounds very interesting. In the pursuit of optimized, tunable systems for artificial photosynthesis. This sort of thing actually I dream about, creating, using plants in order to create electricity. This is where you are, isn't it? This sort of thing. To use sunlight to make energy and produce solar fuels. If we can understand how the structure of these extremely efficient solar energy collectors affects their function, we can copy the relevant designs and the principles to design highly efficient man-made solar energy systems that are tailored to their respective environments. I think it's actually fantastically interesting work with huge potential. And we're very lucky to have Anne-Marie Carey with us. Anne-Marie, take it over from here.
Welcome everybody to tonight's final, of English Speaking Union's public speaking competition. So I understand we've had 22 schools so far compete and 37 participants made it through the heat held in March, whittled down to 8 finalists. So first of all, before anything else, I'd like to congratulate those who've made it here tonight. It's quite an achievement in itself to make it to the final. I think we should have a round of applause. Okay, so I'm going to introduce the judges tonight. We've got 4 judges on our panel. So starting from the end here, we've got Sarah Robertson, who's a national and international debating and public speaking champion. Kiram Ashraf, who's a PhD student at the University of Glasgow and works with me in the Photosynthetic Antenna Research Centre. Rob Mars, who's a former speech and debates officer at the English Speaking Union. And Keith Baker, who's a research associate at Glasgow Caledonian University. So the theme for tonight is our energy future, and you've all prepared a 5-minute presentation, yeah? 5 minutes, yeah? So our timekeeper here, Simon Christie, is going to keep time, and at 4.5 minutes, when you've got 30 seconds left, he's going to ding the bell once. At 5 minutes, he'll give us 2 dings, yeah? And if you're still talking, at 5.5 minutes, he'll give 3 dings, and you have to stop, or you'll be dragged off. So other important points are that if you speak for less than 4.5 minutes or more than 5.5, then you will be penalized. So it's best not to. And following each 5-minute presentation, there'll be a question period, 3 to 4 minutes. So I'll chair that, and questions can come from members of the audience, please. That'd be fantastic if you ask some questions. And also from the adjudicating panel here. And after 3 to 4 minutes, that will be that. The format of the competition, so I think we can start. Ready to go, Carly?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Our energy future, what does it mean? We talk about our future a lot. We all want nice lives, a big house, a fancy car, a pair of diamond-encrusted trainers. Or is that just me? But in order to get to the future, we need to survive. We need food, shelter, money, clothing, none of which would be possible without one vital resource, energy. In order to grow food, our most basic of requirements, we need energy, starting with the sun. The whole process from growth to transport to consumption requires huge amounts of energy. Energy is so vital in our everyday lives, and we do not even realise the extent of it. I want everyone to ask themselves a question. How did I get here tonight? Did I come by car, train, tram? For everyone who came in a car or train, it used energy to make it move. For everyone who came by tram, well, I don't quite know whether to believe you, so congratulations, but that also needs energy to run. The point I am making is that we don't think about our energy consumption as we are consuming. We don't appreciate it, but we use energy on a massive scale. We need to start thinking about it as the sources of energy on which we rely are running out. In 50 years' time, oil production will drop below half what it is currently. In 350 years, there will be no coal on this planet. Gas will run out in 60 years. Once our energy is gone, the world will face a crisis, an apocalypse. So what do we do about it? Many environmentalists propose solutions such as solar, wind and wave energy, while other people advocate extending nuclear power. There is, however, another controversial practice that has been the subject of much debate recently, fracking. For those of you who don't know what it is, here comes the science bit. Fracking is a process used to extract gas from shale rock. It involves drilling the earth and injecting a high-pressure water mixture to release the gas. There have been numerous protests across the world against fracking, with many concerned about the environmental impact. In 2011, two small earthquakes of 1.5 and 2.2 magnitude hit the Blackpool area following fracking. The creation of fracking disposal wells is now thought to be responsible for many earthquakes in various countries. It is also a worry that potentially carcinogenic chemicals used may contaminate groundwater around the fracking site. These concerns have prompted the rise in opposition groups such as Frack Off and Americans Against Fracking, who organise protests and campaign against the practice. But is fracking all bad? Fracking gives us the opportunity to create electricity at half the CO2 emissions of coal, meaning that it is actually more environmentally friendly than some current sources of energy. In the USA, it has boosted oil prices and driven down the price of gas, ensuring North Americans have their energy future for at least the next 100 years. Could we? The British Geological Survey states there are 4.4 billion barrels of oil and shale rocks in southern England, and that there are between 2.2 billion and 8.6 billion barrels in the Weald Basin. We have £15 trillion worth of shale gas undiscovered. So by expanding fracking, we too could have an energy future. I am no environmentalist, I am no conservationist, I am no hippie. Equally, I am certainly no greedy capitalist who wants to destroy the planet and contaminate our waters. I am just one of many people who wants a prosperous future for us all. I understand that my support for fracking may seem fairly controversial, given the scale of recent protest and opposition, and the fact that we have all been convinced that our energy future is supposed to be one which protects and preserves our planet, not further endangers it. In real life, however, if we want to progress, we have to be radical and make controversial choices that not everybody agrees with. If it means giving today's youngsters energy to survive, then what matters more? Nothing. If we can be radical, if we can accept tough choices, it means that our long-term energy future is secure. Our children and theirs can wake up in 100 years in their big houses and walk out to their fancy cars, wearing their diamond-encrusted trainers, of course, knowing their lives are secure. Their energy future is in our hands. Our energy future is in our hands, and I see no reason why we should not make fracking a huge part of this. Thank you.
Well, of course,
obviously we do have an energy crisis just now, but it's nowhere near what it will be in 50 years' time. So I think if just now we can just try and preserve our energy, and in 50 years we will focus more on fracking.
Well, it's nice to hear a controversial speech. They're always enjoyable. I just wondered, what would you actually say to somebody who lived near a fracking site who perhaps is worried about what will go into their water, or is worried that their garden shed will disappear due to an earthquake?
Well, When the earthquake hit Blackpool, there was absolutely no casualties whatsoever. There was no, really, it didn't make any impact to the Blackpool area, so I don't really think people should be concerned. And in Britain, there's been no cases where there has been chemicals, cancerous chemicals found in groundwater around the area. And the government has already pledged to pay £20,000 to members around fracking sites as a sort of way of compensation.
Although we've seen fracking sort of catch on to be sustainable in America, the large quantity of landmass that they have and the ability to use, which is quite a lot of barren land and people is not occupied by people, has seen fracking be acceptable there. Well, in a country with a relatively small landmass, such as the UK, and where human populations are so much closer together rather than the US, that fracking is not feasible in a country with such little landmass to spare. But you can't have the same volume of carcinogenic water near such close together populations. Do you not agree that we cannot have, that the UK is not sustainable because it's too small?
Well, as I said earlier, there's absolutely been no cancerous chemicals found in any water anywhere across the UK. Even though the population may be tightensome in the UK compared to America, there's been no cancerous chemicals found in water, so it's not an issue to the UK. And obviously, America's a totally different story, so it's...
What is energy? My first year teacher once subjected us to an explanation. He droned on about Albert Einstein for what felt like hours, and he waffled through something called, I think it was E equals MC squared? And then realizing that he had completely bamboozled us, he stopped and he closed his eyes, and I think he resigned himself to what he was about to say next. He said, energy is what lets you do stuff, okay? Let's just leave it at that. Energy is what lets you do stuff. It is what allows us to think, feel, and develop. It's all around you. The person sitting next to you, listening to me intently. The person sitting on your other side, noisily snoring along. Quite simply, energy is life. This human energy is our essence, and it's a truly infinite resource. The question is, how do we unlock this potential energy? Well, in order to answer that, we need to know why it requires liberating in the first place. We have a very closed idea of what success is, but now that view is becoming increasingly narrow. We are now all expected to go and attain the highest grades, to graduate with firsts, and disappear into the dreary world of the big three, law, medicine, and, yeah, you guessed it, engineering. We are suppressing our children's energy by dictating the way in which it should be harnessed. As a result, we have dithering doctors, lackluster lawyers, and erratic engineers, and a depressing lack of powerful poets, moving musicians, and awe-inspiring artists. The human race is filled with passion, and medicine, law, business, engineering, these are noble pursuits and necessary to sustain life. But poetry, beauty, romance, love, these are what we stay alive for. Anyone who's seen Dead Poets Society can tell me who said that. Anyone who hasn't, you're missing out. To be born is to be born with purpose. And that purpose is to be impassioned by what we do. Whether that is achieved by being a doctor or a musician, the merits are equal. A doctor can save someone's life, but a person's family, friends, and passions, those are what make that life worth living. After all, a doctor can only care so far for a robot. Long gone are the days of Shakespeare, Rembrandt, and E.E. Cummings, Jane Austen, and Van Gogh. They didn't just write a few silly words or paint a few silly pictures. They captured a slice of life at that precise moment in history. Are these passion chasers obsolete? No. So why are we no longer encouraging people to become artists or playwrights? We must look to the future and we must educate our children. We have to teach them that actually success cannot and should not be defined by others. Ultimately, success should be personal, to be inspirational, to be passionate, to love whatever you pursue. That is success. Our energy is in great abundance. However, this energy is being wasted and not being put to the best use. By denying others the opportunity to suppress your energy, you can create the life that you want to live. Ultimately, ladies and gentlemen, if a person is happy in what they do, they are undoubtedly a much more complete person. A harder worker, a higher achiever, a far more inspirational character. You will leave a bigger mark behind you. These people live life to the full and their energy and harness their energy to better themselves. A Newton or a Shakespeare are rare occurrences, admittedly, but they are not impossible. They are the result of a life spent chasing a passion for what they do and embracing the energy of life. Ladies and gentlemen, everyone here knows that energy is plentiful. It is, it truly is. It's all around us, as I've said before. Life is fundamentally a matter of going out, channeling your energy to the greatest and most rewarding end. We are life, we are energy, and we are the future. Thank you.
You mentioned engineering as one of the big three, and I was just wondering if you looked at university admissions rates, and do you really see the number of people going into engineering as a problem?
Well, my problem isn't with the numbers of people going into engineering and medicine and law, that's fine. My problem is actually the types of people who go into them, because nowadays there's this thing among students and teachers, actually, if you get your 5 A's, you should go into medicine or you should go into engineering. It doesn't really matter if you actually want to be an engineer or a doctor. And I believe that actually the profession of engineers would actually greatly benefit from people who actually want to be engineers rather than are just told by their guidance teacher, hey, you got your 5 A's, you're reasonably great at physics, you should totally go for this. I think that actually our world in general would benefit from having people who are passionate about art and great artists, people who are passionate about being a doctor and great doctors. You need to do what you love to be the best at it.
So I would ask you whether you think that it would help to allow more unqualified teachers in schools who actually come from industry, who are able to provide students with insights that a teacher who's only ever been in the education system might not be able to offer, and whether that might address the issue.
Well, I think despite the fact that we have qualified teachers who have always been teachers, people do find passions within things like art and drama and music, and you know, their teachers have never necessarily been engineers or artists or etc., but people still find passion within that. So I don't really think that you need unqualified teachers from industry coming in to necessarily impassion people or inspire them. What people need to do is that they actually have to get up, go out there and find out really what do I want to do with my life, because it's fair enough sitting back and relaxing until your guidance teacher tells you, well, okay, you're good at these subjects, so you should probably do this. You need to know what you want in order to be able to go and get it.
As somebody who works in the law, and no doubt lackluster, I just wondered if you think that the two are mutually exclusive. We sit almost in the shadow of the Scott Monument, one of Scotland's greatest authors, but also a noted lawyer and sheriff later on in his life. So there's no reason really, or perhaps there's no reason, why an engineer, a lawyer, or a doctor couldn't also indulge their passion in the arts.
Yeah, I think despite anything, everyone has passions and hobbies, you know, because doctors, or at least I don't think they do, they don't go home and they read old medical journals. That's just not what human beings do. Everyone has a pursuit. I mean, I don't think you as a lawyer go home and read up on old case studies. You know, lawyers go home and they kick back and relax, they put on some slippers and they watch Holby City. I mean, everyone has passions and pursuits. It's just, if you have a passion for being a doctor, go and be a doctor. That doesn't mean that you can't also play the violin and love Rembrandt. So they're not mutually exclusive.
Okay, thanks very much, Aisha.
Some eyes look north for our energy future, as a global community, to the pristine Arctic and its oil reserves. I believe that we we must look beyond Scotland and beyond Europe, south to Africa, a continent just as much in danger of energy exploitation as the Arctic. Large-scale energy production is extremely difficult on such a politically and economically unstable continent. And this could cause even further devastation to both our planet and our people. I believe that small-scale renewable technology effectively uses the initiative, inventiveness, and ingenuity that abound in Africa to solve this, the biggest problem, I feel, in the history of humankind. If we were children in rural Africa, we would probably have to travel miles on foot, cook over open fires, and resign ourselves to a poor education due to a lack of energy. For instance, the whole of Nigeria only uses the same amount of electricity as the city of Bradford. According to the NGO Practical Action, over 1 billion people live without any electricity at all in sub-Saharan Africa, where there is the highest level of crushing poverty. Energy can alleviate poverty, as we've seen it do in Europe after the Industrial Revolution, providing people with basic services vital for development, such as electricity and transport. I find the poverty in Africa incredible when I consider that Africa has the fossil fuel resources in countries like Libya and Angola to become the new energy focus of the world. But politics, poverty, and profiteering prevent this. One issue with large-scale fossil fuel extraction in such unstable countries is corruption, where huge amounts of money are siphoned off into the bank accounts of big business, drained into the pockets of fraudulent government officials. A total of $20 billion has mysteriously disappeared in this way in Nigeria alone. Like we've seen in Libya and the Sudan, civil war interrupts energy supplies on a colossal scale, and power theft drains the national grid in many countries, losing further millions of dollars. These factors suggest to me that large-scale energy projects just aren't for Africa. Furthermore, we in the West have been exploiting fossil fuels for centuries. Look where the world is now. Rising sea levels, rising carbon dioxide emissions, a rising level of panic about our energy future. If Africa takes the same route that we have, addicted to fossil fuels, our planet will end up in almost certain economic and ecological disaster. So, if big isn't the way forward, what about small? As the founder of Practical Action titled his book, small is beautiful, and I firmly believe that we ought to be investing in small-scale renewable energy projects which imaginatively make use of Africa's vast sustainable resources. Doing just that, Practical Action has invested in small hydropower projects across vast areas of Africa, and they're currently working on implementing solar-powered water pumps, which are having a huge and extremely beneficial effect, particularly in Kenya. But Western invention is increasingly being matched by innovation from Africa itself. In poverty-stricken Malawi, a young boy called William created a windmill out of old bicycle chains, fans, bits of junk, which has dramatically changed the lives of people in his village and now across the world. Although denied an education, his determination and imagination can serve as a model to show how decentralized renewable technology is so successful, both in improving our people's standards of living and our planet's standard of protection. African governments are catching on, and governments in Kenya, Senegal, Djibouti, to name but a few, are supporting a diverse range of renewable energy projects to power their countries into the future. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe in the power of human creativity. Over millennia, mankind has demonstrated the ability to adapt, innovate, discover. But perhaps we now face our biggest challenge yet. Struggle to eradicate poverty, but build a more sustainable future. As I've shown you this evening, conventional resources are just not suitable for the long-term future of Africa, or indeed for our planet as a whole. I believe that with the creativity and determination shown by people like William, organizations like Practical Action, With initiative from the South and investment from the North, we can help developing nations in rising to a new dawn of sustainable energy for all. The power is in our hands.
How can you tell these countries, undeveloped countries, that have all these resources, coal, etc., etc., not to use these resources while we, Britain, America, and all the developed countries are still using and guzzling it up? How can you tell these countries not to use it?
I think as a society, we're realising more and more that we cannot carry on using fossil fuels we're relying on them too much as a way of life. We need them for everyday life as we are now. But there's incontrovertible evidence that continued usage of fossil fuels is going to affect our planet in very bad ways. Sea levels are going to rise, the ozone layer is disintegrating, and I think that we've got to realise that if Africa uses their huge resources of fossil fuels, for example, Africa currently holds 10% of the world's total untapped oil resources, which is, as you say, a huge amount. The consequences of that will be absolutely atrocious for our planet and for everybody on it. It's not just the West, it's not just the South, it's everyone. And we need to realise that using further and further amounts of fossil fuels is going to have a terrible effect on us all.
It was interesting to hear essentially a talk on development economics. I wonder if there's hope to be had from how Africa is, or how African countries have developed other things. So, for example, phone infrastructure essentially doesn't exist, and lots of people in Africa have just moved to using mobile phones without ever having the phone infrastructure that we have in our houses and our buildings, and contactless payment is probably more advanced in lots of parts of Africa than here. So perhaps a lesson to be learned, it came through very strongly in the speeches, that people don't have to develop in the way that we develop. I just wondered if you had any thoughts on that.
I think that's absolutely true, and in fact I think that Africa should not develop the way we develop. I think that Africa is kind of a clean sheet to start all over again, developing new energy infrastructure which is renewable, which will last the human race for an extremely long time. And I think that you're correct in saying that Africa is a place where we can start again, and we can try new things which we hope will be extremely beneficial for our future as a global community.
I'm afraid we're out of time now, but thank you very much.
The problem with our past is that it was a dirty place, a very dirty place. And when we look at the history of energy, we are delving into particularly dirty places. The Golden Age was certainly a myth. Our energy came from burning woods and then coal. We diverted crystal streams into narrow runs that were soon to leave the factories as stinking slurries, carrying pollution down to the sea and beyond. William Blake's blackened streets were all across the industrialised world. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the backstory that the current crop of thinkers base many of their ideas on. They come, to put it bluntly, from a dark place. This darkness pervades current thinking about energy, but I am pleased to announce that I am here to provide a new perspective on our energy future. I am the blank sheet that our energy future can be written on. I don't have the prejudices of those weighed down with the cares of history. I am the voice of the young generation that can look forward to an inspiring and energetically bright future. To be honest, I'm not actually that unique in this. If anyone has had the chance to look at the recently published resources map of Scotland, produced by the architect group Lateral North, you'll be aware of the amazing energy future that could be ours. Let me give you a flavour of the energy-rich opportunities that await us. Firstly, we must remember that all of our energy basically comes from the sun. We've been good at getting that energy from its stored forms, such as oil and coal, but we are now developing technologies that will allow us to get that energy more directly. Wind, wave, solar, geothermal, hydro, pump storage, these are all one step up from fossil fuels, and we are rich in all of them. Let's be clear, we are not short of energy. The sun delivers 174 petawatts of energy to the upper atmosphere, and my physics teacher tells me that's a lot. We just have to be smart in how to access and use it. The idea of energy shortages are due to two things: the limits of our technologies, and the limits of our imagination. Let me quickly deal with the technological limits. The technology does not stand still. The Model T is not an example of economic technology in action. It was inefficient, expensive, dirty. My great-grandfather thought it was great, and it is still the source of many family stories. But now, every new car that goes on sale sports technological advances that make youngsters like me sit up and take notice. Bike detecting software, 3D mapping, self-activated braking, and 60 mile per gallon hybrids. The technological advances are amazing. The same is true for energy production. By the time the technology is installed and running, it's out of date and needs an upgrade. That's the challenge for the new generation of engineers. When we design technologies, we need to have an eye on the future. Upgrade pathways have to be built into everything that we design and build. And this requires a new way of thinking that, to be honest, comes easier to young folk like us than to, shall we say, older workers. So ladies and gentlemen, technology will take care of itself. Scotland is at the forefront of cutting edge technologies and renewable energies. And we will continue to move forward from the Model T into a brighter future. The second limitation is more difficult to deal with. Although it also involves radical changes in the way we think about energy generation and storage, my granddad keeps moaning about having to switch off wind farms when the wind is too strong and nobody's putting on the kettle. We have to see this as an opportunity, as a challenge, to build better devices to capture this energy. Scotland has something like 40% of the tidal potential generation capacity in European waters. We can, must, and will take advantage of this. Just last week, we saw an announcement of a breakthrough in the use of the metal vanadium in making large, very efficient batteries that could store energy wind generators that can be used at peak demand. This is exactly the kind of breakthrough I mentioned earlier, and it's the result of creative thinking that our finest engineers and designers are capable of. Ladies and gentlemen, if we've learned anything in the last 100 years, surely it's that we keep coming up with new ideas. I don't believe for one moment that we, the young people represented by the speakers in this room, are going to give up in creative and innovative thinking. Ladies and gentlemen, we have made use of the plentiful energy available to us on this small blue planet, using dirty technologies. But we will develop better, more efficient ways of making use of the sun's greatest gift to us. We will use the brightest star in our sky to power our dreams. And I understand that many of us are stuck in the mud, but as Oscar Wilde and Annie Lennox said, we are all of us in the gutter, but some of us are looking at the stars.
Do you think that our education system is actively equipping people to use their imaginations to solve engineering and technological problems?
Well, I think that our schools should be the source of the creative thinking, and they should be the source of how we think and how we get our knowledge and put it into the world to give these engineers and all this technology. We need the schools to start. That's our starting position, and we need them to push us forward, to have an imagination of our own.
Do you think that they're currently doing that or not?
Well, currently, yes, of course our schools are helpful to us, and of course our schools are constantly pushing us with new ideas. But the question that I ask myself is, are they pushing us enough and in the right direction? I think our schools, yes, they do enough, and yes, they try their best, but everyone can always do better, including our schools.
So one of the points that you made was actually a really good point, which was the energy from the sun. So we only utilise about a 1% of the energy that lands on Earth. Do you think our focus should be mainly on the sun's energy and forget about possibly other renewable sources like wind? So therefore all the technologies that are being developed or that will be developed should be focused on one type of renewable energy?
Well, we can't use all these other technologies without the sun because, as I said in my speech, the sun is where all our energy comes from. And as I also said, there's lots of it, there's plenty of it. So I don't think that we should restrict ourselves to just using one renewable energy. As I said, there are so many, there's wind, wave, solar, the list goes on. But I don't think that restricting ourselves to one energy is the right answer.
with your speech mainly focusing on the idea that we needn't worry about our energy future because research will continue to take technologies to the point that we can rely on them without necessary worry, do you believe currently around the globe and in Scotland alone there's enough research to continue your vision that our own research will take us to the point where we don't need to worry about our energy future?
Well, of course there are worries about our energy future, but I don't think worrying is the answer. And yes, I think that research is key and we are doing lots of research and research should be funded and it is needed in this process. But instead of sitting worrying about do we have enough research, do we have enough, we have to focus on gaining more research, doing more research. And yes, I think that research is the answer to how we do in this vision that I have, then yes, I completely agree with it.
Okay, thanks.
Madam Chair, ladies and gentlemen, esteemed judges, as your final speaker, I intend to cast aside thoughts of solar, wind, wave, and nuclear energy and rather look within to consider exploiting the power that we hold. Every time we move, we expend energy. And I stand here this evening as a one-person battery, a human dynamo, as it were, turbocharged and ready to go. It's called people power. Of course, I may be poised for action, but how can my energy be transferred to meet other future energy needs? The average adult contains the same amount of energy as a one-ton battery. Now, obviously, we need some of this energy to, you know, get around, point at things, think, and speak. But what if the spare unused energy could be harnessed to charge your mobile phone? The truth is that there is spare energy in spades in this country. The trouble is that we just can't quite get off the sofa for long enough to convert it into anything useful. The UK has alarmingly high obesity rates, and it's the speed at which these rates are rising that is the most frightening. Since 1980, there has been a 47% increase in obesity in the UK. This means that nearly two-thirds of all people in Britain are overweight. Now, it seems kind of ironic that the lecture we need to hear comes from across the pond, statistically the fattest country on the planet. But in Portland, Oregon, the Green Microgym is already generating 40% of its energy needs by harvesting the energy created by exercise bike. In Rotterdam and London, clubbers are generating up to 60% of the energy needed to run the club, simply by dancing. You see, it's all about potential. And I don't mean the kind of potential you got in your report card. We all know that's code for lazy. Perhaps we don't harness our potential because we're too busy enjoying screen-based leisure activities. Perhaps it is because we are so outrageously privileged that we just can't be bothered directing our energy into the useful, efficient, and productive channels we ought. And when I say useful, efficient, and productive channels, all I'm talking about is walking around. The science is astonishing, but the energy is pedestrian. And the science is astonishing. The technology is in place to allow us to create enough personal energy to charge all our own mobile devices within the next decade. I know it sounds frivolous, it can't all be about iPhones and tablets, but this same technology can be used to actually implant power-generating fibers into our bodies. When our blood vessels dilate and contract, they produce energy, thus providing a source of electricity for pacemakers, insulin pumps, and other medical devices. So, time to pay attention. Here comes the science. Energy comes in many forms. The two I think are helpful in illustrating my point are kinetic and potential. Imagine I held in my hand a taut rubber band, full of potential energy. Some of us can perhaps remember, somewhat nostalgically, how it felt to send that rubber band soaring across a room. For others, the memory may be less cheerful. Maybe you're the sorry victim of said projectile. The physicists amongst you can smugly understand the formula that converts potential into kinetic energy. But ladies and gentlemen, it is only if the rubber band is released that the full extent of the kinetic energy is seen. And that is the point. We have the potential energy in the world, and if it never moves, nothing changes. This brings us to the heart of our energy future. Unless radical action is taken to address the childhood obesity crisis, before too long, we won't be able to stop it. Unless we change the way we live our lives, as though everything were disposable, the basics of life will start to run out. Unless we think again and use our use of fuel, we will simply destroy the fragile fabric of our planet.
Now the habits are ingrained. Soon they will be cast in stone, and with them our future. What might we, as a generation, have to meet to fully face up to the energy crisis in our world as it hurtles like an enormous asteroid towards us? It is arguably the most pressing concern for my generation. William Hazlitt, a philosopher writing in the early 19th century, said, "Our energy is in proportion to the resistance it meets." Perhaps we are not yet willing to expend our own energies, whether in getting involved in these cutting-edge technologies or just simply changing the way we consume energy, because we've not yet fully appreciated the enormity of the resistance coming our way. That said, the laws of physics don't change. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. We don't really have a choice about reacting to our energy future. It's going to happen whether we stay on the sofa or get up and start reacting to the crisis that faces us. We are our energy future. The choices we make, the gadgets we buy, the consumables we throw away, the challenges we set aside to channel surf instead. Madam Chair, ladies and gentlemen, we have the potential energy to change our world. I urge you to convert that potential into kinetic, observable, real energy, to soar like my imaginary rubber band across the globe. This is the meaning of people power. For the people, of the people, by the people. Thank you.
How do you propose encouraging people to embrace this new technology when a lot of people might see it as unwanted violation of their own body?
Well, I really think that they won't find it a violation if we can save our planet, because I don't really think they'd mind being violated, as you say, if we still have a planet in about 50 years.
Just a really general question. If you were in charge, how would you implement this?
I'd say, like, start in primary schools. Like, and I don't mean like in P6, I mean like P1. And like how we have information evenings when you move into a year in secondary school, I think we should have information evenings like that for parents. Because as many people have said tonight, the children are our future. So if we educate the children, like younger than me, to understand what's actually happening, I think that it would make a massive impact.
Could this speaker just clarify whether this elaborate sort of scheme, this idea, you know, human power, is this an opt-in, opt-out thing? Is this going to be forced upon us? You know, is this violation going to be forced upon us? Are we going to have an option as to whether, you know, we participate in this scheme or not? You know, and who's going to administer it? Is it going to be government administrators? Is it going to be administrated by organisations? Can you tell us a bit more about the practicalities of it, please?
I think that it would probably be the government that run it, because, you know, they run everything else. I also think that at first it will become voluntary, but if we don't get enough energy to keep us and the planet alive, then perhaps it will be like in school, if you're on like in the fitness suite, they might use that energy to generate it into actual energy sources.
Great, thanks very much, Julia.
Ladies and gentlemen, our energy future. What do we envisage? An ideal may be the image of windmills adorning every mountainside, hydro dams straddling every river, electric cars buzzing about the streets of our towns and cities. We know that to achieve all this, we must start to invest heavily in renewable sources of energy. This is why, in the UK alone, the government spent over £265 million on such sources between 2000 to 2009. Mountains of evidence stack up to suggest that unless we stop burning fossil fuels and other non-renewables, we're going to end up both running out of power and killing our planet in the process. To a green-minded and sensible individual, this makes perfect sense. We know exactly what kind of future we desire, and we know exactly how to get there. It seems like the silver bullet solution. Even resources such as nuclear power and fossil fuels can be used sensibly to ensure a smooth transition to self-sustainability with renewables, despite the obvious risk and harm associated. The issue is not necessarily with the source of our energy at the moment. We have a variety of possible renewable sources, including wind power, wave power, and hydroelectric power. The future is in fairly safe hands in that regard. Our issue is that we seem to link the term renewable with inaccurate and misleading connotations. We seem to believe that in the future, when renewable energy takes over as our primary source, we can exploit and waste as much of it as we like, without consequence. We seem to believe that the term renewable means infinite. Every day, every month, every year, our population continues to rise, and with it, so do our energy demands. More phones being charged, more kettles being boiled, more washing machines spinning, more cars being driven, more. It seems that despite what we know to be true about energy shortage and usage, we still fail to appreciate the value of the power that we utilise, regardless of its origin. We expect that when we flick the switch, the room will fill with light. We expect that when our laptop needs charging, plugging in will do just that. We expect too much, yet we appreciate too little. If this is our attitude now, then what's to say it'll change in the future? We can only assume the switch to renewable sources will enhance this carefree attitude, and such sources cannot cope with that. Wind turbines, for example, depend on air rushing past their blades to generate power. If there's no wind, there's no warm cup of tea. Even if we build such turbines in extremely windy areas, they can only provide a finite amount of power. Once we cover the land in them, there is no room left for more. Hence, there is a limit to their generational capacity. The same logic applies to wave generators, hydrogen power stations, and so on. We can only build and develop so many before we simply cannot build any more. Sure, they may provide green power for years to come, but if energy demands keep rising, they will not be able to provide enough. So what should we be doing then? Well, firstly, we need to continue to invest in the infrastructure required to ensure that we can become entirely self-sufficient under renewable energy. Secondly, we need to take a good, hard look at ourselves and be more grateful for the energy that we actually consume. We should be less careless about wasting it, and also less careless about what we waste it on. Your TV's on standby. Turn it off at the wall, please. Lights on in the kitchen when you're watching TV in the other room. Go grab a drink during the next ad break and turn the switch off. Charging your phone overnight. Consider charging it before you go to bed. That way, you can switch it off once it reaches 100%, saving power. As Gandhi himself once said, Earth provides enough to satisfy every man's needs, but not every man's greed. So don't be greedy with your energy. Our energy future lies in our hands. It's a future full of uncertainties, and it will only be shaped by our willpower as a society to change. Only one thing is truly certain, in fact, that the future will be different. The question is, people, what will our attitudes be? Thank you.
But I'd like to ask you a question about the energy you need to make the renewable technologies. Do you know about that?
I believe you're referring to where would that energy come from to invest in renewable energy sources. Going back to part of the start of my speech, I mentioned nuclear energy and fossil fuels to bridge the gap between the two sources of energy. Just to elaborate on that, so my vision would be that as time progresses over the next 100 years, we use those sources that we're currently using now, for example, fossil fuels, etc., and that energy is used. Profits from that are used and invested in renewable energy sources. So they carry forward, if you like, and they benefit and they go towards implementing the infrastructure required for those.
Do we have questions from members of the judging panel?
So as society grows, population increases, so we have a demand for more resources.
Yep.
Do you think, as a society, we can just survive on renewable energy?
That's a very good question, actually. I believe we can. I genuinely do believe we can. But I do believe that, like I say, our attitudes need to change towards the way we use energy, as opposed to where we get it from, because it's not simply a case of where does it originate. It's more a case of how cautious are we about, you know, switching things off when they're not being required. Where, you know, do we need to take the car? That sort of thing. So it's more to do with sustaining ourselves on what we can make, rather than just searching to find ways to make more power. So instead of building 100 more windmills because your town turns on 3 PlayStations instead of 1, tell them to just play on 1. That's the sort of idea that I was going for. Thank you.
Okay, I think we've got time for perhaps one quick question.
In your answer to one of the previous questions, you spoke about how the profits of, you know, the burning of fossil fuels can be reinvested in developing renewable energy. And I was just wondering how you propose incentivizing, you know, businesses to start developing this energy, because, you know, fossil fuels are clearly oil and gas very, very profitable, and how would you incentivize them, and how would you incentivize governments into research and renewables?
Good question. That's one I did ponder myself. I believe it's to do with how would you incentivize an oil company or a government, for example, to want to go down that route. Because we look at companies like Shell, who instead of wanting to invest the products in renewables, will continue to invest the money they get from, for example, North Sea Oil into their oil business. And I believe that would be simply a case of legislation, pure and simple legislation, focused on making sure and ensuring that companies don't just decide to take the profits offshore and invest them, and so that we actually see a return on the kind of exports that we actually have. So it would be a case of legislation. And as for governments, well, I feel like an elected government should try and do the best it can for its citizens that it's supposed to represent. So as a result, it should be in its interests to try and focus on renewable energy, because if they don't, then they're basically destroying their own country. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
The title of the speech is Future Plans and Hunger Pangs. It's the glazed look that gives him away, and the scene is depressingly familiar. A boy sitting in the back of his science class as they are taught all about the marvels, the wonder, the possibilities of recent developments in renewable power. Solar panels for roads, acres upon acres of wind farms, hydroelectricity seizing the might of our bracing Scottish weather. Incredible stuff. But he doesn't hear any of it. Now, I'm sure we can all empathise with spacing out in double physics on a Monday morning, but that's not what's happened here. He's not paying attention because he's focusing on a very different type of energy problem. He hasn't eaten in nearly 24 hours. He hasn't eaten properly in far longer. All he can focus on is the gnawing hunger in his stomach and the fog of fatigue in his head. His energy problem is that he hasn't got any. When warnings of an obesity crisis are splattered across the headlines of the newspapers that our homeless children sleep under as they slowly starve, something's seriously wrong. Scotland's food distribution is like a seesaw, one side laden down with fats and sugars that clog up their hearts and rot their teeth, the other up in the air, with no idea when or even if their next meal will come. So while I'll be going home when this competition's over to a home-cooked meal and a bowl of Ben and Jerry's, one in five of the children I pass on the way will be living in severe food poverty. And it was Aristotle himself who said that children hold our future in their hands. Yet we're leaving thousands of young people with no hope of any kind of future for themselves, never mind the rest of the country. These could be the next doctors, lawyers, politicians, humanitarians. But they'll never have the chance because they'll never have the energy. We need to invest serious funding into state-run food banks, into initiatives to get parents into work, and into support for our poorest families before it's simply too late. Real change is entirely possible with the right priorities. Unfortunately, we don't seem to have them. And while we're in an arguably better position than, say, the hosts of this year's World Cup, who don't appear to realise that their starving children can't eat footballs, our attitude is still shameful. I mean, why feed the hungry when you can host the Commonwealth Games, right? Wrong. The possibility of free school meals for primary ones to primary threes was a step in the right direction, but poverty doesn't stop at age seven, and one meal a day is not enough. But what about those who are getting three meals a day? Starvation's not the only nor the main issue we face. Far more rampant in this country is malnourishment. Because with the highest obesity rate in Europe, let's face it, Scotland's become less haggis, neeps and tatties and more deep-fried Mars bars and iron brew. Why have we sunk so low? Well, it's because if there's anything proving just as toxic as financial poverty, it's educational poverty. Our children are not receiving enough social education, including a basic knowledge of health and well-being. And families need to know how to provide our children with the healthy food required to grow, to focus, to concentrate in lessons, and to have the energy to embrace the future. We're one of the richest countries in the world. Nobody should go hungry. Nobody should have a poor diet. And yet recently we've seen money funneled into spikes, preventing homeless youth from sleeping in certain areas, instead of, say, food, to keep those children alive. These are people, not pigeons. And we can talk a big game about feeding the starving, but without a serious shift in attitude, we may as well just say, let them eat cake and be done with it. As a country, we've gotten ourselves wrapped up in political gameplay and petty posturing. This is not about how hard we should be on benefit fraud. This is not about a skivers and scroungers debate, and this is certainly not about what stance on feeding our poorest families is going to win the most votes. This is about the kids. This is about making sure that they have the opportunity and the energy to see the future they deserve. We can do that. We can afford that. We have no excuse for leaving our children to waste away while we're still enjoying that extra chocolate biscuit, because, you know, the diet starts tomorrow. In situations such as these, there is no such thing as only one man. Look at little Martha Payne, who took the internet by storm when she documented her unhealthy school lunches on a blog. A 9-year-old girl raised thousands of pounds for charity and brought to light the serious failings in our school dinner system. And each and every one of us has the power to show those in charge that we will not stand idly by while our children are starved and stuffed by a system that's forgetting those who matter most. We are the public. Democracy gives us power, a vote. Social media gives us a voice. Let's start using them. Let's give our children what they need and ensure their place in our energy future.
In your speech, you advocated state-run food banks, and you said that because people who could be the next politicians or lawyers or high flyers society, then they haven't got enough energy. That's why they are. They're going to be unable to be such. Don't you accept that food banks only really create dependency? They only really ensure that people are going to be dependent on a state that really isn't going to be beneficial in the long term. It's not going to provide substantial support when they need it, say 20 years down the line. And don't you accept that whilst you're giving them the energy, they won't be able to move out and become these high flyers that you want them to become?
I certainly would accept that was the case if food banks were the only thing I was advocating, but what we have to realise is we can't just throw money and food at the problem. It's not going to go away, right? Poverty breeds poverty, but in my speech I also advocated things like education, social education, support for poor families. That doesn't just mean financial, and that doesn't just mean throwing food at them. That means giving them the opportunities, giving them the chance to become more than their poverty has forced them to be. I think there are many ways we can do that and encourage that, and I think that food banks are more to do with the fact that there are people going hungry and we can't just let that happen.
Hi, yeah, you've talked about food poverty, and in my job I deal a lot with fuel poverty, which is people, quite a lot of cases, households who have a choice of either heating their homes or putting food on the table. I was wondering what you would do about fuel poverty.
The solutions to fuel poverty come under a lot of the same headings that the solutions to food poverty come under. Obviously they're not entirely the same. I mean, food banks are not going to help anyone heat their home, but I think at the same time the idea that underlies my speech is that, like, noticing that there are people here who are living in unsatisfactory conditions, unacceptable conditions, and focusing on that in the same way, it's a case of, you know, the idea I mentioned about while we're still enjoying that extra chocolate biscuit, it's the idea of we just need to get rid of this attitude of complacency towards those in poverty. And I think once this attitude is changed, then the help for things like fuel poverty as well as food poverty will fall into place.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. During this past month, when I asked people the question, what is our energy future, I received exactly the same response. Guilty glances, shameful faces, quite a lot of mumbling, a few ums and ahs, and essentially not really much of a reply. I believe that currently the correct response to this question is, what energy future? We won't have an energy future. We will have caused the destruction of our planet and made it uninhabitable for humans, resulting in the extinction of mankind. Certainly, some other species may survive, but our energy future, that won't exist. First of all, let me clarify what I mean by energy. I mean the energy levels within our bodies which allow us the ability to stay alive and carry out actions. And I also mean the general overall health of planet Earth and its resources. Ladies and gentlemen, you may ask why I'm being all doom and gloom upon the topic of energy, but the facts speak for themselves. Worldwide obesity has nearly doubled since 1980, costing us lives and money spent in healthcare, and this figure is only rising. Additionally, global warming has caused an increasingly large number of storms, droughts, and has also raised sea levels, making flooding commonplace and creating tsunamis. Furthermore, the National Resources Defense Council predicts that more than 1 million species could be obliterated by 2050 because of global warming. These facts not only make the future look bleak, but question whether we will have a future at all. I find that comparing Earth to the human body aptly describes our present situation. In order for us to maintain a healthy body weight, our energy intake from food has to be the same as our energy output, otherwise we gain or lose weight. This idea relies upon balance. We need to balance our diet and our activities to remain healthy. I believe that just as this balance is required for the human body, it is also required for planet Earth. If we use resources from Earth, such as trees for building, we must give something back, such as planting a tree, therefore maintaining a balance and reducing our carbon footprint. This idea is explained further if you imagine an overweight person going on a fad diet. After 2 months, they are healthy body weight, great, and they stop their diet, and before you know it, they are overweight again. Their diet was only a short-term fix for their problems. Now imagine someone turning down their heating in summer. After 2 months, they have reduced their carbon footprint. Great again, but then winter comes and they turn up the heating. In this example, just as a fad diet is a short-term fix for being overweight, so too is somebody turning down their heating for 2 months a short-term fix for global warming. My point, ladies and gentlemen, is that just as maintaining a healthy body is a long-term commitment, so too is maintaining a healthy planet Earth. I believe that in this example, the correct response would have been to put on a few extra layers of clothing before turning up the heating. A simple enough response which significantly reduces your home's carbon emissions. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe that by carefully balancing our energy intake and energy output for our entire lives, we can secure ourselves a positive energy future by permanently achieving healthy bodies and a healthy Earth. In the past, we were not innocent of harming the Earth, but we were ignorant. We had little idea how much damage we were doing. However, now we know. In February 2007, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change issued its latest report, which concluded that global warming is unequivocal and over 90% is caused by human activities. We are guilty. This is highlighted by one of our more horrendous crimes. We have been wholly committed to steadily destroying the Amazon rainforest. Each year, the Amazon rainforest absorbs more than 1.5 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide, and it also provides us with over 20% of the world's oxygen. Yet, we are destroying the Amazon at a rate of 20,000 square miles per year. I personally find it perplexing that the same race that nicknamed the Amazon the lungs of the earth is destroying it at such a fast rate. If we applied my human body analogy here, it creates a point of enormous concern. What is the human body without its lungs? A corpse. What is Earth without its lungs? Perhaps we will soon find out. I do not deny that many governments and individuals believe that they are combating global warming, but are they draconian enough? Ladies and gentlemen, I pose to you the question, are we really saving the planet?
The analogy of the human body gaining and losing weight, and I just wonder, you spoke about that you wanted the planet to maintain a balance and so that you weren't destroying the planet, but I wondered what sort of specific measures would you put in place to prevent the planet being further trashed, as you put it. What specific measures would you employ to prevent further destruction?
In answer to your question, I believe that we each individually have a role to play, and if one person does it, it's not enough. We need to do it all together. And I was relating it to the human body because we have a very similar problem. Obesity is rising. I think the Earth and the human body are both natural parts of nature. They've got biology in them, so I thought it was an analogy to make it simpler. But my idea for how it would work is I think we need to do more research. And it presents the idea of carbon offset, because I think many people now have the belief that they are doing the right thing, whereas actually they're not. For instance, I was discussing this earlier on, my parents, If someone goes shopping and they decide, oh, I'm going to walk instead of taking the car, and they go shopping and they come back with their heavy bags, and you think, oh, good, you know, they're producing a carbon offset. But then you think, you know, how heavy was that shopping? How much energy would they have to regain by eating the food they just bought? And food has its own carbon emissions from production, so would it have been better to get the car? Which way are you producing a better carbon offset? And basically, I believe that we need to research more and make people understand more in society.
So I would ask you, regardless how much research we do, we still have an inherent problem that humans can be quite selfish. So what would you suggest to help us overcome that selfishness?
Okay. Well, first of all, I believe that human nature, everyone's going to be selfish. There are bad parts of a person's character, and I don't believe that we can fully overcome that. But by making more regulations, more rules, people will see the consequences and they'll choose not to do the selfish thing because the consequences will be great and they won't want to do it. Additionally, it brings back to the fact that I think people naturally, you know, they're lazy. They think, oh, I could, you know, I could walk, but it's a bit of an effort. I don't really want to do it. And I think that by creating healthy bodies, we therefore have the energy levels to be able to create our Earth healthy. If we're too lazy to do things for ourselves, why would we do it for the planet that we live in?
Thank you very much, Carol Nelson.
That was a very difficult decision for the four of us to make. We thought that all eight speakers spoke very well. We all thought three in particular spoke very well. You all saw that for yourselves. The creativity of young people who can take the topic of our energy future and spin it from everything from obesity to sub-Saharan developmental economics is quite astonishing. And literally almost everything in between. I won't give too lengthy an adjudication because I know that some people have got to catch a train, others might want to go and get some dinner. But just a couple of things. Public speaking competitions are a balance between rhetoric and content. If your content is very good, it doesn't matter how good your rhetoric is. If your rhetoric isn't particularly inspiring, it doesn't matter how fantastic your content is. Also, I'm not a very bright person. And what I quite like from a young person speaking, or indeed an old person speaking, is to be guided by the hand through their speech. What are you going to say? Then take me through the speech and tell me at the end in case I've forgotten. It's a very classic way of putting together a speech. It's quite a good way of putting together an essay as well. But a structured speech with a clear thrust is very good. Some of the speeches tonight had fantastic ideas coming through them and really interesting snippets here and there. But what's really good is if you have a consistent thrust throughout the speech where everybody in the room knows where you're going. And finally, answer questions. Just because we're sitting behind a table, in fact, probably because we're sitting behind a table, please feel free to attack us. That's absolutely fine. If you disagree with somebody in the audience, you know, tell them. You've probably done the research on this. Ultimately, they are unlikely to have done so. So you're probably going to win the argument, and you've got the microphone anyway. So you will always beat hecklers because you can be louder if nothing else. How you answer questions is important. You know, if somebody's taking the time to listen to your speech and ask a question, make sure you answer it properly. You know, give them the time of day, and you know, don't just say no, yes, just repeat something you said in your talk. So, you know, go into a bit of depth, and perhaps the winners did that a bit better than others. We've given two highly commended awards tonight for those who didn't win. We don't have them with us, but we will send them out. And the two highly commended in no particular order were Afton. Annie.
Now, thank a lot of people. First of all, the host and sponsor,
who we certainly wouldn't be able to do this in this kind of style with the money that we have as an organisation, but the Royal Society of Edinburgh have graciously helped with this. Our sponsor, Park, for the catering, the prizes and the filming. The judging panel, I'll see if I can get you in the right order, Sarah Robertson. Rob Mars, the chair and organiser, who's made a great contribution to ESU over the years, and Keith Baker. And the chair of the debate, Anne-Marie, a few words before. Anne-Marie, she has been a great supporter of our Science Debates outreach work since we first launched Speak Up Scotland. With the Scottish Government Science Engagement Grant, she started 3 years ago. She's come into schools with us, engaged with young people, spoken to pupils about her work, and she's also been a great supporter through helping us with sponsorship from Park. But she's now, lucky for them, unlucky for us, being poached from us by an American university. She's going to Arizona, to the Arizona State University. I've been chatting to her over the break, and the kind of research that she's doing into the purple bacteria sounds absolutely fascinating, and you never know, after the work that she's doing right now, might come the kind of breakthrough that we need in the technologies that will take us into the second half of this century and maybe completely revolutionise the way that we get our energy. So we'd like to thank you, Anne-Marie, for all your thanks and your help and your extraordinary enthusiasm. And we have some flowers to wish you bon voyage and good luck in your new post.